Hello, I'm Dr. Fred Venditti. I'm the Hospital General Director here at Albany Medical Center Hospital, bringing you the update from Albany Med. I have with me Dr. Sarah Amendorf. Sarah is our hospital epidemiologist, and she's going to join me today, and we're going to talk a little bit about some epidemiology topics here. So let's go to the first graph. And this is the capital region hospitalization graph. And Sarah, we continue to hover in the same range. We're at 94 hospitalized patients on this graphic today, and really haven't changed very much since the beginning of May. On the regional call this morning, which you participate in, I think the number was 110, right?
Yes, it's down a little bit from last week, but.
Right, and that has a few more hospitals than the capital region.
Yes.
The next slide, pop that up now. This is our hospital census, and you can see we're starting to trail off. So we currently have 21 in the hospital, 7 in the ICU, and only 2 on ventilators. So we had a little bump in the past couple weeks, and now we're coming back down.
Mm-hmm. Right?
So that's all good as well. And then finally, let's put up the third graph. This is admissions and discharges, and you can see there is some trailing off of admission activity, but even more importantly, we've discharged a lot of people in the last week, and that's why our numbers have come down. So that's all good. You know, Sarah, I was on the website looking at some of the other data that the state publishes, and so our 7-day moving average of positive cases is now down to 1.7%.
Yes, we were hoping to get below 2%, so that's very good news.
And 2% is kind of a magic number for us. That's been a trigger, right, for some activities here at the medical center.
Yes, the Infectious Disease Society considers if you're less than 2%, you're in an area of only mild prevalence of the virus. And so then you can start to readjust some of your thinking about some of the initiatives that you've undertaken.
So speaking to that, today the CDC put out some new guidelines. Tell us about those.
So they have come out finally to say that fully vaccinated people can go maskless when they're outside and attend small gatherings with unvaccinated people. So no longer do we need to wear masks when we're walking outside. They recommend that it's always prudent to put a mask on if you're with a group of people. However, now they're specifically stating that with vaccinated people can attend small gatherings.
So that's great. So it seems like we're making progress, Sarah.
Yeah.
Certainly in our region, we've vaccinated at least first dose over 500,000 people here in the capital region. And we heard this morning that we're coming up to that 50%,
yes,
that magic 50% number for our capital region. We'll cross that number either today or tomorrow. So that's terrific.
That's huge.
And that's a good part of the reason why we're beginning to back away from some of these restrictions.
I think we've seen a huge impact in terms of admissions and age of admission. So we're not seeing as many elderly, I don't think, being admitted as we've seen us switch to a younger population.
And you know, it's interesting. So we've been looking at the variants, right, that are prevalent here in the capital region. And those variants, most notably, are more infectious.
Yes.
And so they've begun to really take hold in the community, but we're still seeing the numbers go down.
Yes.
So my assumption is that's the vaccine.
Yes. And there was initial concern that the vaccine would not be effective against variants when we first started to hear about them. But seeing our experience with the vaccine and the fact that the variants are very prevalent in our community is a very good sign that this is happening with our numbers going down.
So tell us about the most recent data on the variants.
So CDC has classified variants to 3 different categories: variants of interest, variants of concern, and variants of consequence. And variants means that the virus has had mutations which allows it to bind more tightly to the host cell. They feel that there's increased transmissibility or spread with some of these viruses. So when they've had mutations, the virus has actually adapted and can be spread more efficiently, as one example. So we are not seeing the variant that we saw, or the virus strain that we saw in the spring. We are now seeing 90% of the time in the variants that we've sent to New York State to be sequenced, we are seeing that this is a new variant and not the original variant.
So it's really fascinating. So the variants that we're seeing are somewhere between 20 and 50% more contagious.
Correct.
Yet our numbers are going down.
Correct.
So really underscores the preventative measures we've taken plus the vaccine.
Yes.
And maybe there are two things for us to cover when it comes to the vaccine. So yesterday in the New York Times, there was an article about second doses. And somewhere north of 5 million people have not gotten their second dose, about 8% of people who've gotten doses. And there's hesitancy, I think, based on side effects, and they think they perhaps have protection already. They don't, though, right, Sarah? They need that second shot.
You need the second shot so that your immunity persists. So there is some degree of immunity 2 weeks after the first dose, but you really need to have that second dose and to have 2 weeks after your second dose to have effective immunity and to have immunity that may last longer.
So if you've gotten one shot but have not gotten your second shot, reconsider that. You probably ought to get your second shot. Now, there is one vaccine that's a single shot.
Yes.
And that's the J&J. And the J&J vaccine, for a period of time, was taken off the market about 2 weeks. But on Friday, the FDA and the CDC recommended that it start to be used again. And so that's important because that's a single shot.
Yes. Yes.
So they based it on, I think, the overwhelming benefit that it conveys versus the very, very small risk. So we were talking about this earlier. For every million doses given, so for every million people vaccinated, it saves 2,100 lives. So it prevents 2,100 people from dying. It prevents over 6,000 people from getting hospitalized. Mm-hmm. And that comes at a cost of two cases of this rare thrombotic event that happens in some people who get the vaccine. So when you weigh that, Sarah, at least in my mind, it's overwhelmingly in favor of getting the J&J vaccine.
Absolutely. The risk of having a clot is much less than having clots with COVID itself. So
That's a good point. Yeah. It's much more common to have clots with COVID than with the vaccine. So again, the J&J vaccine is safe. It's effective, and it's another tool in our armamentarium. Mm-hmm. So we'll pivot to one more thing before we end today, and I want to talk a little bit about cybersecurity, and this is not only for our workforce, but for everyone out there. The bad actors trying to get into healthcare's IT systems, and frankly, IT systems everywhere, has really escalated of late. In healthcare, phishing attacks, bad actors trying to get you to give up your credentials so they can get into our systems, have gone up 189% since December. This was in Intelligent IT Healthcare. It's a publication online. And we've experienced an increase in phishing attacks. There are things like someone gets an email, actually in accounts payable, and it says that the vendor's got a new electronic funds transfer account, so please convert over. In reality, that's a bad actor trying to get us to pay them instead of pay the vendor. So it's something to be aware of, to be mindful of, and be careful. If you don't recognize that email, don't open it. Don't click on links you don't recognize. Don't open up attachments that you're not expecting. Be cautious, be careful.
That's very good to announce.
Public service announcement for the day.
Yes.
So with that, I think we've covered it all today, right, Sarah?
I think so.
You've done a great job. Thank you for being my co-host.
Of course.
So that's it for today. We'll be back on Thursday here from Albany Med. And as Dr. McKenna always says, take care of yourself and take care of each other. We'll see you on Thursday.